Our dear viewers and listeners, we greet you all in the precious and wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is the day the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to today's Bible study. We invite you to invite somebody to join us today as we go through the incorruptible word of God, the word that builds us up and gives us an inheritance amongst those that are sanctified. So as we begin today's session, let's open with a word of prayer. Let's pray.
Father, we thank you.
Yes,
for your grace.
Mm.
Thank you for Jesus.
Mm.
Thank you for the Holy Ghost.
Mm.
Thank you, King of Glory, for your grace.
Yes,
that grace that surpasses all understanding.
Mm.
Open our eyes,
mm.
our ears.
Mm.
Seal your instruction, King of Glory.
Yes, sir.
That we may run with it to all the ends of the world.
Mm.
Reveal Jesus.
Mm.
Glorified as King in our midst, and we shall come back, Heavenly Father, after all is said and done, with thanks, with testimony to the goodness of our Lord and Savior Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Our reading today is taken from the book of Romans, chapter 5, from verse 1 to verse 5. Let's read. It says, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in hope of the hope of glory of God. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. Now, hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, who was given to us. Now, to take you back and provide context, we have over the weeks looked at chapter 3 and chapter 4. And from verse 21 of chapter 3, all the way up to chapter 4, verse 25, we have seen what justification by faith is. So we saw what justification was, and then we saw how we are justified, and we concluded from the scriptures that this is by faith and faith alone, without adding anything. It's not faith and religion. It's not faith and a ceremony. It is faith and faith alone. That is sufficient. Now, having seen that, the writer of the book of Romans now goes to chapter 5, and like a salesman, he now gives us the benefit of justification by faith. Because where we are seated, the question that should be going through your mind is what comes with justification by faith. Let me put it in practice. So if you went to buy something for any salesperson that is selling it to you, be it a product or a service, in order for you to be convinced of what you buy, they have to be articulate concerning what is it that you are benefiting by receiving this product or service. Now, taking it to the spiritual realm, here is what we see. Just as Paul reminded us that justification, and in case you are not noticing what justification was, justification is when God declares us righteous in His sight. So basically what God has done, He has not only justified you in His sight, but He has credited you. And by you, I mean you who has believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. He has credited you with Jesus's perfect righteousness. So your spiritual account is not empty. So God does not just declare us not guilty. He credits us with His righteousness. And it is against that background that then Paul writes and says, therefore, because you have been justified, he says, having been justified by faith, he now begins to list down the benefits. And so that you don't get lost into this crowd of benefits, we will take one at a time and break it down. But I will give you the snapshot of how this looks like. In verse 1, he lists the first benefit, where he says we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. The second benefit is found in verse 2, where he says, through whom we also have access by faith into this grace in which we stand. So this justification grants us access by faith into God's unmerited favor. And the third one is what we see at the end of verse 2, and it says, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And he expounds this hope all the way through verse 4 up to the beginning of verse 5. And let me point out that when we talk about hope, this is not wishful thinking. This is a guaranteed certainty concerning the future. And so we have this. So now he brings us to the fourth point and says, now hope does not disappoint. This is why you will not be disappointed. Why? Because the love of God has been poured out into our hearts, which is the fourth benefit. So the fourth benefit is that experiential love of God that you experience within you, and God has poured it out. It is like God literally smiling upon you. And the fifth one, he gives us and says, now hope does not disappoint because the love of God was poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. Who was given to us. So the fifth benefit, we get the Holy Spirit given to us as a gift. You don't pay, he's given to you as one of the benefits that come with us being justified. And this justification is by faith. Let's now begin to break down, beginning with the first one. The first verse says, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. I want us to look at the first word, which is the word therefore. So Paul here is trying to connect the preceding scriptures, which is chapter 3 and chapter 4, and 3 and beginning 3:21. He now connects that. And I want you to look at the tense that he uses. He says, having been justified. He's using an aoristic tense there, which is a past tense in this respect. So when we talk about justified, he's now talking about an unbeliever who has come to the saving grace of God and has now been justified by faith. And this is important because here you are, what he brings up is the aspect that you are justified the moment you gave your life to Jesus Christ. And I know we need to emphasize this because there are two wrong schools of thought which don't align to scripture. The first one is the one that believes that we will be justified in the future. This text alone nullifies that. It says, therefore, having been justified. So it happened in the moment that you believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. And then there is the other school of thought, which believes that we were justified in eternity past. Now, and this is not correct. So what I want us to be very clear is this aspect, number one, that we are justified the moment we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is an instant moment. It is an immediate transaction that happens between God and us. So the moment you believe in Jesus Christ, immediately God declares you righteous. So this day will not take place on the last day. This takes place on the time, at the moment that you believe. The day you commit your life to Jesus Christ. The day you trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Now, what also that means? So when you trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, like we saw in the case of Abraham, there has to be a turning away. So Abraham had to disregard his physical appearance and turn his attention to the word of God, to what God has promised, and to the ability of God to fulfill what he said he will fulfill. Even us in the same way, when we come to the faith, there has got to be a turning away. You turn away from the world. You turn away from the life of the pursuit of sin. You now turn to the Lord Jesus and believe in him. So having been now justified by faith, the Bible says now we have peace with God. He's using the plural, we have peace with God. So which we is he talking about? The way he's referring to are those people who have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. It is, and he's not classifying them into classes. No, whoever has believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, the moment we are justified by faith, we have, in the present, we have, at that moment, we have peace with God. We have peace with God. Now, and let's break down the word peace. This peace has two aspects. The first aspect is the aspect we call the subjective peace. And then the second is what we would call the objective peace. Now, let's look at the subjective peace first. This one has a feeling aspect to it. And when this is what the Bible refers to as the peace of God. And it is different from what is defined here. What is defined here is peace with God. So when we talk about the peace of God, in practice, that would be like that calm atmosphere within one's heart or within your soul because of your faith in the Lord Jesus. So that in the midst of the storms of life and the difficulties and the calamities that may be around you, you have the peace. The peace of God. The one Jesus refers to in John 14:27. And he says, my peace peace I give to you. Peace not as the world gives. My peace I give to you. So that is the peace of God. It is the same peace that is referred to in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7. When it says, be anxious about nothing, but in everything, with prayer, supplication, and thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. And says, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your mind and heart in Christ Jesus. That is the subjective peace. Now let's look at the objective peace. Now this is the bigger one. This has no feelings attached to it. This means the absence of conflict. It means the absence of war with God. In other words, as far as God and you are concerned, there is no conflict. There is no war whatsoever. Now, to have peace with God presupposes that there was actually conflict or war before. Now, it is a fearsome thing for God to be at war with you. And I know we have had the message of love. And it is right, we need to have that perspective of this loving God. But I need to point you to something. In Scripture, and I've had a lot of, yes, God loves sinners in one hand, and in a specific sense, yes, he does. Because the Bible says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. It was God's love that prepared him to send Christ to die on our behalf. But let's not overlook the other aspect or the other sense that God's wrath is upon all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. Look at what he says in Romans chapter 1 verse 18. He says, for the wrath of God is, this is present tense, is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. So that means even the elect, before they come to this grace, before they believe on the Lord of glory, before they believe on the finished work of Jesus Christ, they are under the wrath of God, according to what Scripture is saying. Praise be to Jesus.
Yes,
now you say, but is that so? Yes. Just let's go to Romans chapter 5, verse 10. Let's pick it from verse
9.
What does it say? He says, much more than, having now been justified by his blood, shall we be saved from wrath through him? So basically what he's saying, it is the justification through his blood which saves you from his wrath. And verse 10 he says, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. Look at what he's saying. He's trying to tell us that before we were saved, you were an enemy of God. So we were enemies. So we were at war, we're in conflict with God. So whether it was active rebellion or passive indifference or you are in between there, it doesn't matter. Before you come to Jesus Christ, God considers you his enemy. Why? Because by nature, you don't have the nature of God. So you may ask, what nature do you have? John chapter 8, verse 44, Jesus says that at that point you are the sons of Satan, children of the devil. So why were enemies, children of the devil? That is when God moves. So now that we have peace with God, that means God is no longer angry at us. He no longer holds any vengeance towards you. So but you may say, but you say God loves sinners. Yes, God loves sinners. But when we read through scripture, we discover in a particular sense that God looks at sinners differently. Look at Psalms 5:4. What does it say? He says, for you are not a God who takes pleasure in wickedness, nor shall evil dwell with you. In other words, no evil dwells with God. Why? Because God is holy. And then he goes on to say, the boastful shall not stand in your sight. Why? Because you, talking about God, hate all workers of iniquity. So God hates iniquity. But God also hates workers of iniquity. In other words, people who commit iniquity. Verse 6 of the same book, he says, you shall destroy those who speak falsehood. And he says, the Lord abhors. The Lord hates the bloodthirsty and deceitful man. That's one scripture. Psalm 7, 11. It says, God is a just judge. And God is angry with the wicked every day. That's what he says. He's angry with the wicked every day. And if you read all the way going down, he talks about if a man does not repent or turn back, what has God done? He has sharpened his sword and bent his bow and made it ready. He says in verse 13, he has also prepared for himself deadly weapons. What is happening here? Because the arrows of God, the weapons of God, are aimed at every one that is evil. And I remember one preacher saying, God does not miss his target. So you need to understand on that. Psalm 9, 7-8, he says, for the Lord abides forever, and he has established his throne. Why? For judgment. Now, need to understand that. So, the reason he has established his throne is to judge. Psalm 11, verse 4-7. The Bible says the Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes behold. His eyelids test the sons of men. The Lord tests the righteous. But the wicked and the one who loves violence, his soul hates. So God hates the wicked. He hates those who love violence. And he says, upon the wicked he will rain coals, fire and brimstone, and a burning wind shall be a portion of their cup. For the Lord is righteous and loves righteousness. His countenance upholds the upright. Now look at that. Now you may say, but it is all Old Testament. Very well. John 3:36. Jesus is teaching from the text where we have, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. That very text, verse 36, this is what the Bible says. It says, he who believes in the Son, referring to Jesus Christ, has everlasting life. Note that. And it says, he who does not believe in the Son shall not see life. But it's not only that. He gives a but. And he says, but the wrath of God abides on him. So if you do not believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you're not a recipient of his love. No. What abides on you is the wrath of God. And I want you to note the tense here. It says the wrath of God abides on him, present. It's not in the future, now it abides. Now, I want you to note that. Well, let's go to another scripture. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1-3. He explains our plight before we come to Jesus Christ. And this is what he says. And you he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins, in which you once walked according to the course of the world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. What is happening here? The disobedient have the spirit which spirit proceeds from the prince of the power of the air. And he is now working among these sons of disobedience. Look at verse 3. He says, among whom also we all once conducted ourselves in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and the mind. And he says, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the others. So as sons of disobedience, you are children of wrath. That goes away when you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And I want that to register in your mind. 1 Thessalonians 1:10. It talks about and wait for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, even Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. So if it were not for Jesus,
we
would be candidates of that wrath. Now, for you to understand what this wrath is all about, then you need to go to the book of Revelation to understand the wrath that will come, that will be revealed when it manifests upon the sons of disobedience. For we see in Revelation 14:9-10, and he talks about that of the angel coming and pouring out the wrath of God. We see the same in Revelation 20, verse 10 and verse 15, when he talks about that. But let's go back to where we began. The Bible says, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God. So we went from a state where we were dreading what God would do to us. Now we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, here is amazing, something amazing. And I will bring it to the practice. I happen to have three names. Now, when somebody calls me by one name and says, John, I may not take it so seriously. But if somebody calls all my three names, I know this is very important. So I stop everything I'm doing and turn my attention to whoever is calling out. And it happens to us. Now look at what is happening here. He says, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. He uses Lord, uses the name Jesus, and uses Christ. Now, Lord is an amazing one. Is the Greek word kurios, where we get the word, where we get the understanding of sovereignty. So it reveals Christ, or Jesus Christ, as the sovereign being, as king, as the supreme being who is in control of everything upon this universe. So when we come to Jesus Christ, and this is very important, we come to a new Lord. So we have moved from darkness. We have moved from one Lord. And we now are under another Lord. We have a new master. We are under new management. You see, when you go to an organization and there is a change in management, things don't operate the same way they were before. Because new management has come in. So you are now under new management when you come to Jesus Christ. You are under new ownership. And that should sink in with you. He then uses the other words, Jesus. Now, Jesus,
yes.
When you take it from the Hebrew, it would mean Jehovah saves.
Now,
look at what the angel says in Matthew chapter 1 and 21. And he says, you shall have a son. You shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. So when we are looking at the name Jesus, we are looking at a savior. So how did he provide this salvation? He did it twofold. Number one, through his sinless life. So in his sinless life, he kept to perfection the law of God. So he met all the righteous requirements of the law through his sinless life. And then his substitutionary death. Now look at what happens here. Because we are sons of disobedience. He obeyed the requirements of the law. And he perfected what we could not perfect. So he obeyed on our behalf and secured the requirements, the righteousness that we would have broken. If we tried to achieve the same under the law. So, I want you to look at this. That Jesus' life and death secures for you and I a package. His sinless life, his substitutionary death. So in his death, he shed his blood. And through this, there are about three terms that I want to introduce us to. The first term is the term propitiation, which we saw previously in Romans chapter 3 and verse 25, which says we have propitiation in his blood. Now, propitiation means satisfaction of the wrath of God. So what happens when we look at propitiation, you are looking at words like satisfied, appeased, placated. So what happened is, through his death, I don't know which word you want to pick amongst those, the wrath of God was propitiated. It was appeased. It was satisfied. And that's why the Bible tells us in the book of Romans chapter 8 verse 1, And it says, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Why? Because the God's wrath and anger was propitiated through the Lord Jesus. I want to look at the next term, which is the word reconciliation. And we will look at this in depth in the next chapter. But what I want us to see here is what he's trying us to say. Reconciliation. And I want us to go forward and then we will look at it in detail as we look at chapter 5. Verse 10. He says, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son. Much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. So what happened? First you had the propitiation.
Now,
after propitiation, then came the reconciliation. Now, reconciliation means standing in the middle between two parties who are in conflict. And cannot get together. So you come in as an arbiter, you come in as a mediator. So the one who stands in the middle is the mediator. And it is now the mediator who sets the terms of the reconciliation of these two parties. So in one hand, he brings both, with both hands, he brings these two parties to the table. And he removes the enmity that existed between them. Look at what 1 Timothy 2:5 says. It says, for there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Look at what it says in Colossians 1:20-22. It says, and you, who once were alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now he has reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and blameless and above reproach in his sight. What is Paul trying to explain here? He's painting a scenario of the Lord Jesus holding the hand of a holy God in one, and in the other, the hand of a sinful man, and brings both together. And how is that possible? Why? Because God is too holy, and we are too wretched. So he does that through his blood. And he did that on the cross. Now, to be a mediator, you have to be impartial. So he had to be impartial on the side of God and impartial on the side of man. He has to be equal on both sides. And that's why Jesus fits this profile. Because he was truly man and he was truly God. So given his nature, he would have God on one side and men on the other and reconcile them. He was able to bring us together. Therefore, the Bible says, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God. The third term is the term redemption. So he not just bring them to table, but he met the terms that enabled this to happen. How? By purchasing men out of the sin market. So he paid the price, he ransomed us, he bought us. We are now his possession. So now he is able not only to reconcile us, but to buy us. So we become his own. Now looking at the three, and the three that we talked about is propitiation, reconciliation, and redemption. All of these are purchased through Jesus Christ. So the Lord Jesus Christ, the one anointed to be able to do this, now becomes our passage for us to have peace, the objective peace with God. So to you, the believer in Jesus Christ, there is no conflict with God. I happened to be alive at the time when the government of Uganda changed hands. And when the people got to know that the war was over, they poured onto the streets celebrating. So why were they celebrating? Because there was no more war. And that is a reason to celebrate. Now that is the physical. But now I'm taking you to the spiritual realm. Because of what Christ has done, because of propitiation through his blood, because he has reconciled us in his body, and because he has redeemed us, you are not at war with God. There is peace. Perfect peace. You are at peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now to you who has not believed on the Lord Jesus, the wrath of God is still upon you. But today, that can change. Through Christ, you can find peace. Peace with God. If you have never given your life to Jesus, this is your day. Go to the Father. Ask his mercy. Ask his forgiveness. Believe in what Jesus Christ has done. And through the Lord Jesus Christ, you will have peace with God. Let's pray with you. Say, God of heaven, I am a sinner. at variance with you, with your wrath upon me. I am a son of disobedience. I need a savior in my life. Lord Jesus, save me. I believe you are the savior of the world. You came in the flesh, died on the cross, was buried and rose again from the dead. And you will come again as judge. I believe in your finished work. And I ask, Lord, that you fill me with your spirit. From this day, change me. That I will, the righteousness of God will be credited to my account. And I will have peace with God. Thank you for saving me. Amen. If you say that prayer from the bottom of your heart, you have been wonderfully saved. You are at peace with God. There is a number on the screen. Please call that number. Someone will give you the first steps into this wonderful journey where you are at peace with God. No more war. No conflict. God smiling at you. God at peace with you. Now, for you, the believer, let's take this message to the end of the earth and draw the sons of disobedience to become the sons of obedience. Propitiated. Reconciled and redeemed. God richly bless you. From Dominion Church International, it's been a pleasure having you today. Until we meet again, we say shalom. God richly bless you.